right here. Well, thank you, everybody. And thank you to Robin and Alistair and Karen. It's really great to be here today. And I'm also really excited because our session has props. We actually have props for today. Yes, we do. We have got, if you haven't seen them, the props are right there. There's the Moore machine over there. And then there's one over here. And has anyone had a chance to use the machines? You got one. Oh, you won. Excellent. Great. Okay. Gosh, I'm too short for this thing. So I'm very excited about that. And can I also ask how many people in the room have been using Apple Pay this year? Oh, this year. And it's only been a few days. Okay, good. or other forms of mobile payment. Great. Terrific. Well, we've got a great discussion that we're going to have around mobile pay and mobile wallets and brands today. And I'll just start off introducing myself, and then we'll go into introductions from the panelists and then get into a great discussion. So Laura Rich, Street Fight. Briefly, the best way to think about us is like TechCrunch for local. So we publish tech news and host tech conferences, and our primary concern is the technology that enables relationships between retailers and or marketers and consumers at the local level. And so we look at a number of ways that this is done, whether it's through mobile targeting, maybe it's through daily deals, maybe it's through local search marketing. There's a number of ways, and increasingly, mobile payments and mobile wallets are a way for local marketers to be connecting with local consumers. So very excited for us to discuss this today, and I'll kick off with Pierre, if you could tell us about yourself and your company, and specifically maybe one thing you guys have been working on in the mobile wallets and payment space.
So my name is Pierre Barbeau. I'm from Kansas City. I grew up in Quebec City, Canada. Any Canadians here? I think there was one earlier. There you go, doctor over there. Our company provides loyalty, engagement, and monetization services to the unattended retail space, in particular the micro market industry. We also work with banks developing loyalty programs that tie together their merchant services with their consumer businesses. And we work in a number of other retail areas, including grocery. One of the best ways maybe to describe what we do, if you look at that vending machine over there, if we were involved in a solution like that, our goal would be to help our client get more transactions out of the people using that machine and get them to increase the number or the size of the transactions that they have within the machine. So we have technology and customer experience capabilities that allow us to do that.
Hi, I'm Amelia Powell. I'm the Senior Director of Marketing and Public Relations for USA Technologies. We're here for a lot of different reasons, but you know, one thing that I've noticed as we've gone through the morning is that there are certain topics that keep coming up time and time again. Everyone's talking about safety and security in banking and digital payments. Everyone's talking about this frictionless consumer experience that everyone is looking after. People are trying to understand how digital transactions can really truly engage through loyalty integration and what the benefits in that loyalty integration will be both for consumers and for the operators that are the merchants that are selling things and big brands. USA Technologies has been thinking about this for a long time. We're, you know, the market leaders in the unattended space. And when you think about unattended, it's any time that you're making a purchase without using a cashier necessarily. So we found that by leveraging technology, you can really solve for all of these problems. When you get into the security element, it's a PCI level 1 compliant transaction. When you layer on these digital payments on top of that with biometric tokenization and all of that, you're really creating that experience that all of the customers are kind of, that's what the end game is for everyone. We made an announcement just this morning that our integration with Apple Pay and the Apple Wallet was completed. And you can demonstrate that integration in our both of our machines that are on this floor. The thing that's important about it is the fact that you can just hold up your phone, make a payment in just a couple of seconds, and it'll be asked to join the loyalty program. Being able to have that frictionless interaction is the goal here, and I think that's the goal for all of us. It's just making it so that it's easy and people can be rewarded the way they expect to and the way they should, because in the end, it's recreating that brick and mortar experience that people loved 100 years ago through technology.
Okay, thank you. And just to clarify, that the machines are from you guys.
Yes,
we
there are machines. They're
articulate
there to demonstrate
that. So, yeah. We're having some weird feedback. I don't know if there's something we can do about that. But, okay, great. Thank you, Amelia.
Sure.
Manish?
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Manish Patel. I'm founder and CEO of a company called Brandify. We've been in business, so this is our 20th year in business, serving retailers, restaurants, manufacturers, insurance companies, and so forth. Multi-location businesses, in effect. And our mission has been to take the connected consumer and help them find locations nearby. And we do that through owned properties, through properties like on Google or Apple, and also we provide reputation analytics. So what we are here for is, how does the other side of the equation talk about? I mean, we all want to have frictionless experiences, but from a brand execution perspective, you know, that's one of the challenges that we find so often in terms of the technologies that are deployed, the capabilities they have, and the consumer's desire for such technologies.
Great, terrific. Well, thank you. I think we have sort of all the right perspectives up here in terms of getting consumers to a physical location, what they'll do there, and increasing the sales and the returns. So we'll be talking a lot about mobile wallets and what they can do in that regard. And I guess I kind of wanted to just flat out kick off by saying, you know, do we expect that mobile wallets are going to be an essential staple in the marketing mix? Yes or no? And what will that look like? Will you have to do that? Will you not have a local presence, for example? Will you not be able to create a lasting relationship with the consumer if you don't play in this space as a marketer? Yeah.
No. I'd be happy to start with that. So I think that mobile wallets are definitely here to stay, and I think that it will become a bigger and bigger part of the economy as time moves on. We expect to see faster adoption of the mobile wallets now that more and more merchant locations have NFC equipment on site. The EMV requirements that got everyone to upgrade their technology is making it so that those NFC terminals are everywhere. And so as a result, people, you know, have a lot more access to using these digital wallets. And the next step into making them truly the common method of payment is going to be integrating that loyalty piece to it. Now that that's been done and it's been proven that it works, You can look at every credit card brand for the last 20 years. They understand that the way to truly make any payment mechanism the preferred method of payment is by rewarding the consumer seamlessly at the point of sale. And now that's possible through this type of technology.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, as Bluetooth also gets adopted as well, mm-hmm. you're going to see an increase explosion in wallets, mm-hmm. but more importantly, it's about the information that you can give back not only to the brand, mm-hmm. so the consumer has a transaction, but can you feed that information back to the actual brand? Mm-hmm. And when that happens, what you saw with India as an example, the country actually mandating something, it almost feels like the brands are going to start mandating things,
right.
You know, to the retailers,
sure.
and saying, hey, I want this to happen. So you're going to see that conversion happen.
Or sometimes when the brand and the retailer are sort of the same thing.
That's
like
right.
Starbucks, for example.
That's right, exactly.
You know.
Yeah, when they're the
yeah.
same item.
Yeah, that's an interesting point. They will be setting that tone for the consumers. Yeah.
So my Canadian experience comes into play here a little bit. So when I moved here back in the 90s, married an American girl in Kansas City, I remember showing up with my debit card, a Canadian Royal Bank debit card, and my wife was writing checks at every grocery store we would go to, and I remember asking her, what are you doing? You know, why aren't you using your debit card? So there's something about the American adoption rate when it comes to payment is a little different than worldwide. I think it's been discussed today. I was just in Montreal last week, and I walked into a McDonald's, and I didn't talk to anybody. I ordered a custom-made hamburger with my children. They have a beautiful machine like you have here, and it's unattended. And basically, you make contact with your phone. You can pay with a credit card as well, and you can basically custom order anything you want. Stuff that, you know, I've never seen offered by McDonald's before. So I think in a lot of ways, as new technologies come forward, as it becomes more convenient, and as it becomes, as there are more incentives to use the mobile wallet, I think that's the moment in time where we're going to really start to see a real adoption. So maybe a year or two from now, when you ask the question, who here has done mobile payments, everybody's hands would be up by that.
Everyone would keep their hands down because they'd say, come on. Of course we have. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. That's great. So you guys have mentioned Bluetooth and EMV and different technologies. And so what we're really focused on the mobile pay, not the EMV. That's sort of the premise here. And what are the challenges for brands in terms of EMV versus mobile pay, or are there none?
Well, you know, it's interesting. We expected, so in the unattended space, EMV is a tricky proposition. I mean, the liability shift brought up the question, you know, should unattended operators be, you know, equipping their hardware with EMV terminals, and the fact of the matter is, when you're only talking about a sale that's only a dollar or two, it really doesn't make sense for them. So the liability shift wasn't a big deal for the unattended industry, but it's interesting because all of this new technology being out there is giving us an opportunity to watch this kind of leapfrog effect where people have the opportunity to use the EMV card. They put in their card and it beeps at them and makes a bunch of noise.
Yep.
But so instead of dealing with getting yelled at by their terminals, they start to use their, you know, mobile wallets, and it becomes this situation where they just need to get over that hump and sort of understand how to use it.
Yeah.
Our industry has been interesting because we found that unattended has become kind of this gateway tap where you try it out in a private environment and people check out their mobile wallets, see if it works. When they realize that it's easy, they're more likely to go out into the world and use it in other locations. So. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I think the mobile payment industry is in cahoots because the new chip card created pain at the point of sale that didn't exist before.
Right.
Everybody had been trained to swipe.
Yeah.
Now we have to put our chip in. It takes twice, three times as long. So it's created pain I didn't have before. So now there's an alternative mobile payment.
Yeah.
It is quicker. Mm-hmm. So maybe that's an incentive, right? So the more those kinds of things occur,
right,
I think the more the transition.
Well, but I guess happen. I mean also from a brand standpoint, the benefits of EMV versus mobile pay. And I would think that mobile pay, you develop a relationship there. You're capturing more information.
Absolutely. Now that you have technology similar to the VAS protocol that we implemented in our technology, you're able to really get a lot of insight into who the consumer is, find out if they're interested in registering for any kind of a loyalty program. And once they're registered for a loyalty program, you can really follow them and incentivize them in like very specific targeted ways.
And do you have a specific campaign going that you've done that with?
We implemented this. This is the first demo of this. And the next step is to start doing retargeting campaigns and making sure that customers are being incentivized to make multiple purchases in a row.
Right.
It also gives us the ability to identify all, for instance, Apple Pay users and then do some kind of a surprise program where they might get a free product just for using Apple Pay. Whereas in the past, that might not be so possible because with the tokenization, it's shielded.
But I think it finally closes the loop. I mean, at the end of the day, 90% of commerce still happens offline.
Yeah.
And everyone that spends online marketing dollars, they want to close that loop locally.
Yeah.
And then this is a way of bridging that gap. That's one. Second is, obviously, once you have you know, you're on the phone as you cross either geofences or mm-hmm. even within the store. Yeah. You know, you're in a specific department, and all of a sudden a notification pops up.
Right.
You start to, you're interacting with that consumer mm-hmm. at a very very personalized way.
It integrates with all the other ways you're interacting. I'm glad you brought that up, because I think that's one of the key elements here, which is that we're not talking about an opportunity or targeting just in and of itself. It works against this backdrop of marketing that's been going on. Pierre, I feel like you had something to say.
Oh, I just responded to your question. We mm-hmm. do operate a loyalty program in over, you know, several thousand micro market locations across the country. So basically, on a real-time basis, when transactions take place, mm-hmm. We're able to monitor the purchases down to the SKU level, mm-hmm. And then develop campaigns based on our technology. Our clients can basically run programs to incentivize those customers based on those purchases by tying current and future purchases. If you buy this with this, get a discount next time right. on something else, or the same thing, buy 40s, get one off, that mm-hmm. sort of thing. So, mm-hmm. You know, those programs are out there today to some extent.
It's a proven model. I mean, you can see it in Starbucks and Dunkin' Donuts and all of these places.
And so I guess the question was more about that, applying that to our EMV or mobile pay. Does one of them create more of an opportunity than others in that situation?
Well, sure, because with EMV, you're really not getting an opportunity to interact with the customer.
Right.
You're just making a payment with EMV, whereas with the mobile wallets, you have a lot more insight.
Right. That makes sense. So let's do talk about some of the opportunities within the payment platforms themselves, or the wallets, you know, whether we're talking about banner ads, instant offers, and we've touched on some of these. But is loyalty really going to be the main thing that comes out of this, or will there be opportunities for brands to, you know, pop up a banner ad just for branding purposes? I'm not sure if that's useful, but
the ones that we're using are, mm-hmm. our clients and they get to put on their phones. Mm-hmm. We actually embed location inside of the coupon. So there's a coupon, or there might be 10 store locations.
Yeah.
And those 10 store locations we can update. So there might be a Dick's Sporting mm-hmm. Goods, and all of a sudden they travel, mm-hmm. and another 10 can get loaded.
Oh,
so when you cross those mm-hmm. Dick's Sporting Goods, you get the same offer whether you're in Los Angeles mm-hmm. or Chicago. Mm-hmm. So you're by geography or by location, you're actually changing the content. Now this is like level one.
Right.
There's no payment here.
Right.
But to get the adoption, the usage,
right.
Getting them used to having something on their phone. You know, the boarding pass is an example, the theater ticket,
right.
The concert ticket, etc.
Right.
Those are examples of how we get comfortable with technology.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So I think that's like step one, and you keep moving or evolving into things like loyalty and mm-hmm. payment.
Okay.
So from our perspective, there's basically four data sets that we use to run the loyalty program. A transaction is an important one. It's probably the most predictive. But we also use behavioral data. We use location data and demographic information. Some of that is volunteered by customers. Other demographic data can be appended or searched through social media and brought back into the mix. So with the right segmentation tools and triggering mechanisms, you can really run a really effective loyalty program, kind of set it and forget it, monitor the effectiveness of it and on a periodic basis, basically be real time, but I guess some more effective ways on a monthly basis, go back into the machine and basically make the adjustments necessary. But the four data sets, I think, are key mm-hmm. to really bringing it all together, because at the end of the day, it's about creating a contextual experience for the end user. And try to get them to transact again more often and increase the size of their transactions.
Yeah.
I mean, personally, I see loyalty as being the turning point for all of the mobile wallets. Now that you can truly and relevantly integrate loyalty into these mobile wallets, that's what's going to make the difference and convince consumers that this is the way to pay every day instead of, once in a while.
Yeah. Right. And so let's also talk about how much of the dialogue with the brands right now is from their direction or your direction towards them.
Well, you know, one of the nice things about the type of work that we do is that we have an opportunity to engage with brands across all of our 300,000 devices across the U.S. So there's a lot of conversation back and forth about how we can best leverage the information that we collect for brands in a relevant way. And now that we have the opportunity to create these loyalty programs where we can have very specific and relevant messaging, that's certainly possible.
Yeah. I mean, Manish, is this something that's a regular part of the conversation with clients? Are they bringing it up? Is it coming to you?
It depends. I mean, obviously, they look at consumer behavior. In our case, over 70% of our traffic comes from mobile devices. So, mm-hmm. you know, consumers on the move.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're thinking about a consumer wanting to find something nearby, wanting to find a product nearby, and trying to go through their search, find, buy, discovery process.
Yeah.
When they're using a mobile device, obviously, there are things like apps that come into play. And today, yeah. now, it's about things like Alexa and whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
So the interface, I think, is kind of irrelevant almost. Like, mm-hmm. there'll be windows of time, and you'll have the app, and then you'll...
Yeah.
But it's mostly about what the consumers are doing, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they need to understand, they want to be where the consumers are, where they're congregating.
Right.
If it happens to be mobile, then that's going to be driving them.
Right.
If it goes to things like Alexa, or if it's just no interface at all, just like voice,
mm-hmm.
They're going to move in that direction. They're going to be pulled, actually, by consumer behavior, I believe.
Yeah.
No matter what we say as technology, vendor, providers, or
yeah.
what they may have.
Right.
But I think it's really, consumers really pulling.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and I would say from our perspective, we've been doing this since 2010, and, if I compare things today to back then, there's a lot more pull on the part of the clients
uh-huh.
than back then when we were really trying to explain to them, the basics of all this stuff, right? So mm-hmm. they're really starting to get, they understand the concepts, they understand, obviously they understand where the market is now. I mean, even 2010, believe it or not, people were still not grasping text messaging because you still were paying per message on your phone. I mean,
mm-hmm.
all these things, right, have all gone away now, and mobile is here, we're all doing it. So we don't have to go through that step. And I think a lot of companies are really starting to better understand the information that's behind all this technology. Mm-hmm. Because for the most part, a lot of folks are familiar with what they see.
Mm-hmm.
It's an app and they think it's this, but the reality is it's all in the sky. There's a whole bunch of stuff going on in the cloud. And they're starting to understand that. And that helps us a whole lot.
Makes your job a little easier.
It certainly does.
But I think there's a big gap. I mean, it depends on the brand. You're talking about, people like Starbucks.
Yeah.
And then you're thinking about the small business owner.
Right.
I can't text a small business owner. Would then expect that they probably don't have this kind of payment methods.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's a lot of, technology pieces that have to come into play.
Right.
To bridge that gap. So
right.
So one thing to talk about Starbucks.
Yeah, Starbucks is the poster child for every sort of innovation in retail tech. Yeah,
right.
Seems to be.
And mm-hmm. and you can see how Starbucks has been successful in doing it, because what they focused on right from the beginning is the consumer experience and making sure that consumer comes central in the thinking and in their interaction, making it easy to get in touch with that purveyor saying, hey, my coffee wasn't hot, or whatever it is that they want to say. They can easily get back to that. Starbucks also has that opportunity to push out information about holiday specials and things like that. And that's why creating these loyalty platforms that go hand in glove with the mobile payment platforms becomes really important, because you can create a device that way where in an unattended or in a completely anonymous situation, people can get back to those operators and say, hey, there's a problem, or you did a great job and I just wanted to say thank you, or even reaching out to them and saying, as a brand, maybe Frito-Lay gives you a whole bunch of free products, so you can send them messages saying, you can get this free product at this time.
So, go ahead.
No, I was just adding one thing to that is, another nice feature of the ability to use this data, in the case of micro markets, for example, they don't all have the same products on the shelf. So each location could have different product sets. So
mm-hmm.
the ability using this information can really make a big difference.
Yeah. So I wanted to bring up a couple of things. One, Manish, I like that you were mentioning apps or voice, and you know, wallets are just wallets right now, but they could change in the future, right? I mean, is that one of the ideas, or is that wallets would be here forever, or we could have another way of connecting the transaction with consumers and creating a brand experience?
Right now, the wallet is on your phone.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, tomorrow there's no interface.
Right.
Your phone is the interface.
Right. Exactly.
If there's no interface, then mm-hmm. it's going to be in the background somewhere.
Right.
And
exactly.
That will evolve.
Yep.
So in that sense, it'll still be around.
Right.
It's a matter of how.
Right. Because I guess I want to clarify that we're not just talking here about there's a nice place somebody could put their logo, you know, or even a loyalty program. This is a new dynamic between brands and consumers, a new way of interacting.
Yeah, and I think it goes back to, you know, the online identity to the physical identity, and then once I know who you are, I may not need anything from you. You walk into my store, and I've identified who, you know, some characteristic, and boom, I mean, you know, Amazon has a grocery store.
Right.
And there's nobody there.
Right.
It's like, so that's an example of...
Yeah, that's the new Starbucks experience 2.0 when Amazon's pushing for. None of us have seen it yet because it's not open to the public, but it will be, and it'll be something to see.
I hear it's great.
It's got to be. So, to that end, I mean, you know, Walmart Pay, Starbucks, mobile order and pay, there are different things you can do. You can have, do you think that Dick's Sporting Goods needs to have its own sort of its own branded payments like that?
I think what's happening is eventually the answer is yes, and the reason is, again, back to data. Because now what we're doing is we're pushing data to Google, we're pushing data to Facebook, and where the brands are themselves losing access to who their customers are.
Right.
So why does Kohl's have a pay, and why does Walmart have a pay, and do I have to have a pay for everybody?
Right.
You know, likely that's the direction, and then we're going to have, just like app fatigue, we're going to have pay fatigue.
Right,
and
I like
we're
that.
Going to have issues with that, but at the end of the day, it's like, unless there's some way of getting access to the data, they're going to force it on you. They're going to say, in order to get this discount, you got to use, or this loyalty program, you're going to have to use my version.
Well, I see what you're saying, but I think I would respectfully disagree in the sense that now some of the mobile wallet payments allow you to link up your loyalty programs automatically, so that you're not pulling up that Dick's Sporting Goods loyalty program. When you make a payment at a Dick's register, you're automatically going to have that loyalty program applied. And personally, I think that that's the direction that the loyalty programs will go in, so that they're making it a little bit simpler for the payment process to go through by using these larger, more established methods of that's the question.
If I use that, I mean, who's
share
own
the data, but then there's the question.
Well, the loyalty information that brand would own.
Okay.
Because once they provision that loyalty program into the wallet, they have access to that data, but they don't have to deal with any of the payment piece.
Right.
And that's what makes it kind of a win-win for everyone, because that's where you can really understand your customers and be predictive about the types of, you know, programs and rewards that you're sending to them.
If anybody here is skeptical about mobile payment, it's not particularly wallet thing, but a payment thing. You want to experience something great, go to Sam's Club on a busy Sunday afternoon, download the app, it's called Scan2Go, I think, and go about, get your product, put it in your cart, and walk right out the door while everybody's waiting in line. It's an amazing thing. I did a few weeks ago, and it's pretty cool.
But just to sort of jump in on that. I mean, I think that's an experience that's based on Walmart Pay, right?
I don't know, it
leverages Walmart Pay, and the attraction is you don't have to have your phone to interact at a point of sale as you would ordinarily, and that creates loyalty not just to the brand because you get the great products at Sam's Club, but you have an experience that drives that ongoing desire to want to use that store.
Yeah, in the case of Sam's, you don't go to checkout. You go right through.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So you don't have to check out.
Correct.
You walk out.
Convenience.
That is checking out. Checking out is walking out.
Yes.
Right. sort of automated. You know, one of the things that we were meant to touch on was millennials and how they are a really big part of the story here, because there are way more of them. They are than any other generation right now, and they are they do everything on their phones. And so I guess part of the question there is, are they really the ones driving this? How is their behavior shaping and defining it? Are we seeing that yet?
There was a great study that Urban Airship put out about, I think it's called the State of the Mobile Wallet Industry. And it talks pretty specifically about who it is that's using mobile wallets. And it's the millennials, which we could all have guessed, but it's also high-income households tend to use mobile wallets at a much, much higher frequency than any other part of the population. And if you think about it, those two demographics are both so attractive to brands, and that is one of the reasons why this is such an important conversation.
Okay. We have a few minutes. Should we go to Q&A?
Sure.
Okay. Are there some questions? Okay. Sir?
Maybe this has already been covered elsewhere, but how many people in this room have a wallet?
How many? A physical wallet?
A physical wallet.
Yeah.
So, when, you know, what's the frame of time for the disappearance of that wallet, and why are all of us going to switch?
Well, I guess the question is, what's in your wallet? You know,
Capital
if it's a bunch of, it's a bunch.
Isn't that a commercial?
Capital One.
So,
I think that's a great question, and you know, I would take it a step further and say, what would you prefer is stolen? Would you prefer that your wallet be stolen, or would you prefer that your phone be stolen, and your phone
Neither.
Is a payment device?
Neither.
No, but what would you prefer? Like, if your wallet gets stolen, or do you know all the phone numbers to call all your different credit card companies to turn them off? Do you know everything that's in it? Are you sure of all your cash? If your phone gets stolen, you're gonna go online and turn it off.
But I think it's more, if the things that are in the physical wallet don't have a digital or mobile equivalent yet, they're still in the wallet.
Right. I mean, your driver's license,
Your
library card.
Yeah.
For those of us who still go to the library.
So when my days prior to Moblico, I was at Sprint. I was a part of the team who built early apps for 3G networks. So the camera phone was my project. But we used to sit around and ask that question: What day are we going to leave the house? You know, you take your keys, your wallet, and your phone. Mm-hmm. Right, and we're like, one day you'll just take your phone. Mm-hmm. We still have keys, and we still have a wallet. I think probably one of the biggest issues with the wallet is the driver's license. Somehow, someday, somebody will crack that nut, but it's still
a chip in your head.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The chip in your head.
Okay, sir. Like platform?
Yeah.
Like Apple versus others?
Right.
Yeah, I had that question too. I don't know if there are some thoughts on that.
Well, on the iPhone, it's going to be Apple's Apple Pay.
I think that's a great question, but personally, the direction that I see things going into is having a few big players for the mobile wallets that will continue through time, and that more and more brands will just start integrating their loyalty programs into existing mobile wallets so that they don't have to deal with the payment platform.
Yeah, there's
you're from PayPal, so PayPal will still be around.
Yeah,
I saw the PayPal
jacket. Yeah, there's
even though Apple's in the house.
Yeah, there's an interesting assortment of experts here.
But I think that
PayPal and Apple.
The platforms aren't so different one to the other.
No.
Where there's a lot of standardization.
If I'm a merchant, you know, to me, you know, is it Visa, is it MasterCard, is it Apple Pay, is it, you know, there it is, fees, that matters. Otherwise, it's the data. So the loyalty programs matter, right? So I want to have control of that information. After that, you know, the market will determine that.
So I don't think. Technically, from the experience point of view, like, if you take Walmart Pay, since it's Walmart and you can actually integrate into their like inventory and all that, the user can walk in, the customer can walk in, scan the items, and then pay right on the mobile and walk out of the door.
Yeah.
I mean, those kind of experiences would be probably much more easier if the retailer itself has like a Walmart Pay, as opposed to Apple Pay trying to customize every retail experience. And I don't know if you have any.
I'm not sure if it is. I'm looking at our Apple friends here. I'm not sure if it makes that a difference. It's you're selecting how to pay, right? So whether it's a link card, right? You know, XXX, four digit, or if it's Apple Pay, or if it's PayPal, it's a choice, right? But the user experience is the same. I have to make a choice.
But I think your question
nine
is
nine times out of ten, people are going to follow what type of hardware they've got in their pocket. Mm-hmm. You know, whatever works best for their technology. Apple has been amazing in the way that they've developed a lot of technology to kind of bring it all together and make sure that the user experience comes first. But there's lots of options for people who have different ideas about what type of technology they want to use.
The advantage that the device manufacturer has is the control of the device, being able to develop software, integrate it tightly with the experience of the device. You can download something else, but that will always give an advantage to the device manufacturer. Having worked for Sprint, we had that benefit years past.
Terrific.
I don't know. I think it's a cross-platform play. I think that there's something that rides across the device-based ecosystems, and I think there are going to be some interesting plays made in that space by interesting players over time. I have a question, though, for the panel. We talk about loyalty in the context of a tangible quid pro quo for taking an action. I buy something, I get points. I buy something, I get a discount. But I think about the experience that Starbucks is creating with Mobile Order Ahead, and now so many other players in that space are too. And just one curiosity, would that be as effective in the mobile app absent Starbucks and their loyalty proposition? Is Mobile Order Ahead, in other words, enough of a draw to drive loyalty and experiences like that to drive loyalty to a brand? Or do you need to have that other thing that goes along with it?
Just as an example, if I was ordering takeout and I'm stuck in traffic, if I had their technology where they knew that I was stuck, they wouldn't put the order in, and they put the order in 5 minutes before I arrived at the restaurant, if that's what they knew, and it was always hot when I got there, I'd be loyal to that brand without any discounts, because they gave me an experience that was unlike any other one, and that's the difference.
Yeah, you make a great point. It's about the customer experience in the end. You know, you ask about the Mobile Order Ahead with Starbucks, and I think that it's popular because people can look at a line and stand in the store and just place their order and get their coffee. But the reason why I think it's really relevant and really interesting is because when you go to use the Mobile Order Ahead, it makes suggestions for you.
Mm-hmm.
It asks you if you want the same coffee that you get every day. It kind of, again, it's recreating that old-fashioned brick-and-mortar customer service experience that people 100 years ago would go to the general store and they would ask, you know, Joe, their general store guy, for their order, and they would just serve it up. These mobile apps and the technology sort of makes that happen for people in the modern world.
Yeah, I agree. I think the experience, not necessarily connected to a discount or a quid pro quo, is, I hope, the next level of innovation in loyalty. And I'm getting the evil eyeball from Alistair, who's telling me to stop talking. So
we were so close to on time.
We were so close.
Okay, so we do need to move on. Thank you all very much for this amazing discussion.